afternoon. Good afternoon. Wow, it's so awesome to be here. Yeah, North Carolina to me is kind of home. I'm from Richmond, Virginia originally, but I did a lot of growing up in North Carolina and went to college here. So we're going to keep this focused on music, and I want you to ask me anything. We need to have an open forum here. First, before we start, though, I wanted to thank our host, Kuntal Shah, and Casey here at the school and the band program here for having this awesome festival. That's incredible. I also want to thank people that helped to make this possible, folks like Dynasty, Bergero, Innovative Percussion, Zildjian, Evans Drumheads, Meinl Percussion. These are all companies that help me and work with me on, from time to time. We also want to point out to a gentleman over there, his name is Aaron Buck. Aaron, raise your hand. Everybody say, hey, Aaron.
Hey, Aaron.
Aaron brought this marimba up here this morning from Columbia, South Carolina, probably. So, is it snowing yet? We'll play a snow day piece, yes. Instrument. What's the biggest intimidation?
Wrong note.
Wrong notes. I don't want to play the wrong notes. Anybody felt that way before? Come on. Everybody. I do not want to play the wrong notes. Okay? So now, let's think about the instrument in a different way. There's no wrong notes. You can't hit a wrong note. Whoa. So what are we doing here? We're going to try to be expressive, utilize the instrument to its capabilities, but yet not worry about wrong notes. Then we're going to back into playing the right notes, whatever it may be. Okay, it could be, you know, it could be some very, some very famous work, you know. You know, where we're. I'm in the wrong key. Here we go. This is really embarrassing. What key we're in? We're in C major. All right, here we go. There it is. So we're going to find the right notes, okay? But in the beginning now, we're going to think about this instrument as producing sound, and we want to have expression, okay? Now, the trick is that we have to know what the instrument can do, right? Okay? So the first things first is we want to get great sounds. So from here, just like with Matt Penlin this morning, Matt's in the room? Where's Matt? Okay, he's not coming to my clinic. I'm going to talk to that boy. All right. I put my mallets on C's and G's. Okay? Should sound really good, right? Okay? Feels pretty good. It's right off the resonators. Okay? I'm looking at the instrument. We did this yesterday with the Inlo kids, so you don't tell the secret here, okay? But listen, we're playing along, all right? And my good friend Erica now over there comes on, and I'm like, yo, Eric, what's up? How you doing? Now look, I look down. My hands are still on C's and G's. You with me? Okay? So it's going to sound good, you know? Mom's going to like it. It's going to be awesome. Okay? But check this out. I didn't move anything with my hands, but all I'm going to do is stand back up straight. Check out what listens to the sound. Super simple, super easy. Most people don't do it, okay? This is gonna guarantee at least I have a strong potential of getting a great sound, being straight and square to the instrument. You might say, whoa, 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 I saw Juan Alamo over there. And he's playing like this, all right? Good for him, okay? He's pretty awesome, marimbas, by the way. Okay, but you know what? This is very unusual position. Do you have to do this on occasion? Very rarely, thank God. Okay, but most of the time, we're straight and we're forward to the instrument. Everybody good? Now here's another key point of the moment here. Because we want to be able to create sounds and be expressive. We want to make really good tones, but we have to understand how the instrument works. Let's talk about it. So on this instrument, these bars are primarily tuned by a human with a knife, basically, a grinder, to tune each bar artistically to the fundamental, okay? What's the fundamental? What are we gonna talk about with the fundamental? What am I talking about? You should know. What are we talking about with the fundamental? What's the fundamental in music? Go for it. Okay, how about you? Okay, come on, talk to me in music. What do you think?
The primary pitch,
the lowest possible note that's gonna come out of that bar is the fundamental. With me? Now you think, well, of course it is. Why not the fundamental? What's going to happen here, this bar is going to change pitches, right? All of a sudden we have this pitch coming out. That doesn't sound the same as this one. It sounds a little different. Wait a minute, where is it? Oh, it's right there. Why would they put this pitch over here? Okay, so it's a basic law of acoustics to create this marimba bar to have that kind of production in tone. It has to be tuned to the second octave in the overtone series. Okay, ready, cool? Okay, super simple. So there's the fundamental, there's the harmonic. Hear the pitch? Hear the difference? Now, how can we use that? Here's the question. Now, in order to make that fundamental come out, I'm gonna go back to our tone here in the phrase. If my hand is below the mallets after the stroke, I'm gonna get more fundamental. If I'm playing, you know, in a decent spot on the bar, which is going to be near the center. So, here it is. Very straight ahead. Now, ready, got that in your ear? Let's check this out. Let's do the opposite. Now I'm going to play this instrument, but I'm going to leave my hand above the mallet after the stroke. Everybody understand what we just did? The first one is from here, right? The second one is from here. Now, here's the second one. Here's the first one again for your ear. And here's the second one. Ready? And. Are they different?
Yeah.
Okay, the question is to you is how are they different? Tell me, how is it different?
More overtones.
Which way? Which one?
Lower one.
With my lower, I have more overtones? okay? Let's listen to it again. See if everybody agrees. Okay, and then the other one. Which way do you want to go? Okay. Say it again.
The one above.
The one above. She says the one above has more overtones. Is there anything different? And what is he talking about with overtones? Oops. Okay. All right. This way should sound more articulate too. Less resonant. Okay, and he's right. More overtones. Okay. The other way is going to project better and have more low end. Do you hear it? Okay. Awesome. Now, how do we use that? Okay. I'm driving the car and I see all these buttons and the wheel and the pedals. Everything has a function. I have to know what's going to work. Same thing's going to happen here. So if I know that if my hand is up higher, I can create a more articulate, higher partial note. Hear the difference? Okay. Now we're going back to this. No wrong notes. Now I want to be able to be expressive. Okay, I want to use those capabilities of the instrument given these mallets, but to be expressive and not to be worried about playing wrong notes. Okay? So the first thing is just to have decent technique. So let's start off with somebody who has a little bit of background in marimba, but not playing a lot. Not playing. You raise your hand first. Why don't you come up? What's your name?
Ken.
Ken. Okay, Ken. Come on up. Everybody say, hey, Ken.
Ken.
All right. Where are you from, Ken?
Southport, North Carolina.
All right. So, and you played a little bit of marimba, but not much?
Not much to achieve a real goal. I mean, I've played around with it.
Okay. So we're going to talk, what is the first thing that you have to do when you play the marimba usually? What's the first thing your teacher tells you to do?
Pick up the mallets.
But I mean, after you picked up the mallets, it's hard to play it without picking them up, right? All right, yeah, we're going to pick it up. So what's the first thing that the teacher's going to ask you to do? Come on. The grip, yeah, we know the grip. We're going to check that with Mr. Ken here. What's the next thing? On the instrument, what's he going to play?
Scales.
Okay. Is this on? No. I was going to make it a big deal. Scales. Okay. Scales. Name me an instrument where the first thing you have to play on that instrument is scales. What other instrument plays scales right from the beginning? Strings? Piano? Have you guys ever taken a piano lesson or string instrument? String lesson.
Yeah.
They don't make you play scales in the beginning. Okay? They don't do this. Is there any instrument besides the marimba and the xylophone that they ask you to play scales right from the beginning? Well, the vibraphone. The poor vibraphone. Yeah, yeah. Okay? So Ken, we're gonna not worry about scales for him right now. How about we're gonna play these five notes? Just five notes, okay? If you, my son Kevin, who will play with me tonight on the concert, he's playing, he's a saxophonist, he's a wonderful saxophonist, and he played piano for years at home. His teacher was only five note patterns, all in the key of C in the beginning, like C for like a year and a half. I was so happy when he came home and started playing in G. He was like, thank goodness, you know, we have a new key. Why do they do that? They want you to be playing music, you have to be comfortable. To be expressive, we have to be comfortable, right? So we're going to ask Ken to play. I'll tell you what, I'll just pick a pentatonic one. Just an F. Just straight up. Just five notes. Just do it. Mm-hmm. Great, awesome. We're going to ask Ken to stand up straight. Don't put his feet to the side. We're going to stand up straight to the instrument. We're going to choke up just a little bit on the mallets. Okay, that might be a smidgen too much. There we go. That's about right. Awesome. Now he knows that that's the beginning of F major, right? Do you know that?
Yeah.
Okay, good deal. These mallets are designed for four mallet playing, so we're going to choke up a lot on this instrument. Now we're going to improvise a little bit, and you can use those five notes, okay? In any of those five notes in any order that you want, okay? Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay, let's try it. discussion with each other, have you ever talked with somebody that wasn't listening to you? Yeah? And you're saying something and they're like, what? Well, you're not listening to me. Okay, when we play music with people, we have to listen. We have to be the best listeners because we're percussionists. We add energy, we add color, we add vitality to music, we add everything. But we always are usually layering our color on top of the orchestra, top of the wind ensemble, top of other ensembles, okay? We have to listen. So I'm not gonna ask Ken to listen to me now, and you play with something on those five notes that you think might work well with what I'm doing, okay? Here we go, I'll do something similar. Okay, he had to put it, like he talked about with the metronome, working his hands to create that kind of delivery. Same thing's going to happen here. Now, what we're going to try to do is deal with a technical issue, but not worry about the notes that he plays. He had a good hand position, good body position, and now we're going to work on notes that go like this. You're going to play figures like this. Something that goes on with five note patterns. One, two, three, and. And the tone and the expression matter, okay? You can do this in your practice time. It's fun. It can be creative, okay? And here's the most important thing is that as soon as the door shuts to the practice room, you can start making music on the first note, okay? We don't have to go through 20 minutes of this. You know, and go, okay, now I've done my 20 minutes of scales. Now I can start playing music. No. You can play music from the first note. It's all about your perspective, okay? It's all about how you think about it, okay? So, we're gonna take, do you know the F major scale?
Yes.
Okay, so let me hear you play the F major scale. So we're gonna talk about it. He's got a lot of motion in his body just to play one scale, to stand up straight. Very good. We're gonna use a lot more wrist, just relax. We're gonna use a lighter touch. Lighter touch, Ken. Ready, and go, and. Your mallets are coming up to the top of your chest. We're just going to relax. Ready? And go. And. Now make the music sound more sweet. This is a sweet scale now. The sad sweet scale. Okay. Yeah? Okay. How we think about it is important. Check this out. Okay. You think something is important, it's going to relate in how you act about it and the decisions you make about it. Okay, you think a piece of music is beautiful, then how you play it is probably going to be perceived as being beautiful. You think that piece of music is not so good, it's pretty boring, it's pretty ugly, then that's how we're going to hear it. Okay, it's your impression. Now, Ken is preparing a piece of music. Are you playing a piece of music on the marimba now?
Not on the marimba.
Okay, so if he was playing the etude in C major that I was butchering earlier, okay, is that if he felt like this was a really bright, vital piece, a piece that was bouncing and fun, then that's how we're going to hear it. Okay, I'll tell you a really awesome story of a student I was teaching in Santiago, Chile. Okay, I was there for 10 days teaching. Had a girl come up to play for me. I see a lot of music. I see a lot of marimba music. But she brought me something I'd never seen before. It was titled Number 8. Okay, I remember that. And she said, I said, okay, let's hear Number 8. She played it. She couldn't speak any English. And I can't speak any. I can speak a little Spanish, but not enough to. Okay, you get the idea. So she plays. It wasn't very good. Everybody in the room knew this isn't very good. So I'm thinking, how can I help her? Okay, so we start to talk through a translator a little bit about technique, and I finally said, wait. Through the translator, I said, please, I want you to give this piece a name. It's not Number 8 anymore. You're gonna give a piece, a title to this piece that makes how it makes you feel, okay? And she looks right at me. Remember, she couldn't say, you know, oh, my name is Maria, Mr. Four, you know. She couldn't say this in English, but she looks right at me and she went and said, claustrophobia. Claustrophobia. You know what claustrophobia means? I said, oh, 16, 16, okay. Let's play claustrophobia. And then she took a breath. She played this little 32-bar etude. It was completely different. It was completely different. Okay, and everybody in the room went, whoa, what happened here? Because it wasn't so much about what she did with her hands, it's how she felt about it and how she connected with the feeling. Okay, I gave her just an opportunity to name the piece, and she played this piece completely different. Okay, it happens every time. And if you think it doesn't happen, try it, okay? Feel about the piece that you're playing, it has a certain aspect and it's gonna come out. Let's play, let's do it, let's play, stay in your F major scale. You can improvise in F major with those 5-note patterns, but now let's play a sad snow day. Okay, can we play a sad snow day? Okay, here we go, let's try it. Ready? And. Seeing this instrument as it might be if it was a suspended cymbal, okay? Seeing this instrument as it might be in terms of color and tone direction and how it's gonna add to the rest of the ensemble, or in this case, in a solo situation. We've gotta be able to play technique, okay? I use what I call a Musser-Stevens grip, okay? Non-cross-stick grip. How many of you guys play with this type of grip here in this room? Okay, probably most of you, I'm assuming. There's a couple of other grips that people use a lot. I use the Burton grip fairly often, especially on vibes, sometimes on marimba, okay, depending on the piece. Then there's another grip called the traditional grip, okay, which is primarily originated in Asia, but is often used in certain areas of this country and especially in Europe as well, too. Anybody play with those other two grips in here? The Burton or the traditional? Okay, awesome. It doesn't matter. You know why? Because when you turn on a recording, okay, never once in my career have I been listening to a recording of a marimba soloist and would go, oh, what a great grip. Okay, you can't hear a grip. Okay, you understand what we just said? You can't tell if a snare drummer is playing matched or traditional off of a recording. What can you hear is the music. What you hear is the quality of the instrument, the tone of the instrument, and that's what we want to do here, no matter what grip you use. Okay, the grip is a tool. Okay, the grip is not the end. The stroke is not the end. What is the end is the what?
The sound.
The sound. It's got to sound good. Okay? You with me? Somebody like Juan walks into the room and he's going to play a solo. Okay? People are going to be touched by the expression of the instrument, the tone of the instrument. Okay? Nobody's going to walk out of the room going, oh, that was a very accurate performance. Okay? People don't go to concerts for that. Nobody cares to spend money for something like that. They want to be touched. Right? They want to feel like music touched them, okay? And that's what you're trying to do. So first off, how do we do it? Okay, we're going to go to the basics. We're going to start talking about exercises a little bit. And then we're going to talk about understanding the keyboard a little bit more. First thing about the keyboard is about making sure that, like we talked about, in really great positions, like we talked about, good posture, We already talked about that, right? Okay. Second thing is that we're going to keep our hands lower than higher. Okay. Hands lower are going to be good. Now this kind of business. Okay. With some people, this really works. Seriously, because this is a visual art form. Okay. So you cannot deny that. That if you do something like hey, in this kind of, and you're throwing your hands around, people are going to watch that. They're going to see that. They're going to feel it. Okay, still got to sound good, but the bottom line is that after the mallets leave the keyboard, what happens is really just perception. Okay, I'm going to tell you leave your hands as low as possible. Never see a point where you've got your hands coming up in the air. This is a bad idea. This is like somebody playing basketball and he's going past the 3-point line and thinking I can make it. Probably not. Okay. Hands low, be accurate, be consistent, okay? You want to play this instrument and play it well? Play in the middle of the bars, okay? Don't play on the edges, okay? You only play on the edges when you absolutely have to. You go here after this doesn't work. Is everybody cool with this? Okay? This is not the default. And let me tell you, there's lots of times when you have to go there, for certain. But this is going to be the first choice. Why? Because just like with Ken. This is unacceptable. I played all the right notes, but it's not going to be acceptable. Right? What happened here? What happened? Tell me what happened. Yep.
Not as much like she.
Okay, maybe. But there's one really basic problem. Nailing the note. I'm really good at it. I'm really good at hitting that note. Okay? All right, you'll see a lot of people do that. Okay, oh yeah. Okay? And you know what? You know what's going on? The ears are saying, that's good. That's cool. You know why? Because muscles aren't very smart. Okay? What's inside your brain is what's smart. And you're going to tell, no, that's not acceptable. I want to have a great sound, so I'm going to make sure. You have cameras, you can park the camera right here. You can see when you're playing in bad spots. Okay? It's so easy to do that. You've got great teachers in this area that can look at you and go, no, your playing spots are bad. But you've got to be great listeners. Okay? You've got to be awesome listeners. You've got to be able to understand what your sound is because you're an individual. Right? Okay? Let's go back to you, my friend. What's your name?
Jack.
Hi, Jack. How are you?
Good. How are you
doing? Are you a big marimbas? Well, that's okay. That's awesome. It's all good. When Jack, what's your favorite instrument? Snare drum?
Bass drum.
Okay. Right on. Okay. You're not helping my analogy. Okay. All right. Right now you're a snare drum. Okay. So Jack goes into the room and he wants to play snare drum. And you know what? A lot of auditions are behind screens. Okay. We don't get to see the person. We don't know who they are. So we're only going to listen. His sound, his articulation, his delivery is unique only to Jack. No one's going to be able to play it like Jack. Okay? How do we develop that kind of sound is by listening to ourselves. Okay? Anybody ever pointed to you and said, hey, you've got something right here. You know, maybe some mayonnaise dropped or something. You ever had that happen to you? You go, oh, where'd that come from, right? You didn't even know there was a problem yet, but as soon as you see the problem, it's not a big deal. You clean the jacket or the shirt or whatever. Okay? So we talked yesterday at the Enlo concert clinic, about every morning, getting up in the morning and doing a really basic thing that we do. I'll pick you. What's your name?
Lauren.
Hi, Lauren. Okay, Lauren, you live close by? No? Okay. So you're going to school, what year are you in school?
Freshman,
awesome. Lauren, when you go to school every morning, do you look in the mirror? Yeah, is there ever a day when you go to school that you don't look in the mirror? Never a day. Okay? So check this out. If Lauren looks in the mirror every day, she's not looking in the mirror to make a subjective judgments, right? She doesn't look in the mirror and go, oh, not today. I'm not going today. There's no way. You know, she looks in the mirror and goes, oh, I have to brush my hair, you know, makeup or comb, whatever. She's got to do things and she leaves and goes to school. Everybody cool? Okay? Now, when we are as musicians, when we listen to ourselves, and we turn on a recording of ourselves. We're listening to a recording of ourselves. Okay, it's like looking in this mirror. Everybody understand what I'm saying? You're going to look in the mirror and you're going to say, this is who I am at this moment in time. Okay? It could be a snare drum roll. It could be a bass drum lick. Okay? Or maybe with a section. And we're going to listen to it and we're going to not look at it and go, this is awesome. This is terrible. No, these are not things. What we're going to do is do exactly what Lauren was doing before. Oh, what do I have to do? Oh, the rhythm is not clear. I need to fix the rhythm. Oh, I'm missing the note in bar 8. I need to work on that. Oh no, the phrasing is off. I'm missing the dynamic contrast. How do I know? I'm looking at the music. Okay, I'm listening back to the recording and I see that I'm not doing what the composer wanted. Everybody cool with this? Okay, it's about listening. Now the more Lauren listens to herself, she's going to have a better sense about who she is as a musician, what her capabilities are, how she's playing this piece. Okay, record 3 or 4 times a week. Wow, big changes are going to happen. You with me? I've been very humbled and honored to be able to teach at the University of North Texas, really an amazing place. So many amazing players have come through that hall. And I had one graduate student that came through, was doing his master's with me. And he was a good player. He was a really good player. Not a great player, but he was a really good player. And I've been giving him lessons for 3 semesters. He was in his final semester as a master's student. Pretty good. He's going to give his recital. And then one day, he walks in, he says, I'm ready to play my lesson, fine. I sit down, and he starts playing his piece for me. And it was incredible. It was really good. It was really good. Like, better than I'd ever heard him play before. And I let him go. I didn't want to screw it up. He starts playing. He finishes. I'm like, wow. I was like, what'd you have for lunch today? You know? And I said, you should eat that every day. No, I was making a joke. But I finally said, hey, what did you do? What's different this week? And he said, you know something? He goes, I've been here for 3 semesters, and you make me have a book to my lessons. I bring a book to every lesson, and you write in every lesson. You tell me things. And I was looking through this book, and it said over and over, record yourself, watch the music, make the markings in your music of the things you need to work on, record yourself. He goes over and over for 3 semesters. He says, you want to know how many times I had done it? I said, no, how many? He said, 0. I never did it. Okay, until this week. This week, I recorded every day. And I looked at it because he had a recital coming up and he wanted it to be good. And oh my goodness, he jumped up like several steps on this lesson. And it didn't matter that it took him 3 semesters. The point was that he got it. You know, he got to the end point and he saw and he actually was smart enough to go, I should try this. Okay, let me tell you, he gave one of the finest recitals we've had in a long time. Amazing, because he was so in tune with listening to himself and cleaning and fixing his performance and fine-tuning his delivery. You can do it too. You don't have to wait. This is a very precious, precious time for you. I'm going to be honest with you, because I was sitting in these seats not that long ago. In fact, when I was in your role in high school, we didn't have events like this, really. Okay, I got a chance to study with the timpanist at the Richmond Symphony, and he changed my life along with my band director, but I never sat in a room like this as a high school student. This is a precious time for you. You want to be good at what you do? You have to be focused. You want to be good at what you do? You have to practice, and you practice every day. You know? Do you want to love every minute of it? Yeah, you want to love every minute of it, but do you? Not always. You don't have to love every minute of it, okay? But you can see where you're going. And if you record yourself, you can see the progress. And if you've got a great teacher, which you guys do, then you can take that progress and really turn it into something special over a long period of time. Okay? Make no mistake, this time you're going to blink your eyes and all of a sudden you're going to be out of college. You, those of you in high school, you're going to go, whoa, where did those years go? Okay, am I wrong? This is exactly right. Those of you that are out of college, you know this. This is a precious time. Work hard. Don't let anybody tell you no. You follow me? There's no B plan for you. Okay? Jack doesn't have any B plan. He's going to be the best bass drummer ever. Okay? Right? Why not? Who's going to do that? You know? Who would tell Matt Penland that he can't do what he's accomplished already in his short career? Wow, amazing. Okay? You don't take no for an answer. You go for it. Okay? And you go for it by taking the advice of the people that came before you, because we're here to try to help you avoid the problems we had. Everybody cool with that? Because we're not perfect either, Lord knows. Okay, but we're here to help you. And we're here, and these fine teachers that are in the room, all these college teachers and the high school teachers, they know, because they've been through it, okay? So your deal is like, I go home, I'm tired, I don't want to spend 30 minutes on a pad or on a piano or a keyboard or whatever. You know what? But that 30 minutes will set you free. Seriously, you spend 30 minutes a day working on technique and some music and some sight reading, it's a big deal. It's a big, big deal. How many of you guys are underclassmen, sophomore and freshman? Sophomore and freshman, those guys, taking out, check this out. I'm going to tell you, 5 minutes a day. 5 minutes a day, you put something on the snare drum and you read for 5 minutes. An easy Garwood Whaley snare drum piece. Something easy, Wilcox and rudimental 150 solos. Something that's very doable. Read it for 5 minutes, put the metronome on, don't break the time, boom. You're talking about, you've got 3 years to do this for 5 minutes. By the time you're a senior, you're going to be reading like killer. Okay? 5 minutes on the marimba, 5 minutes on the snare drum. Okay? Tell me that this doesn't work, because you'd be wrong. If this works. Okay? Because every time you pick up the instrument, the mallets, you've got to work on three basic things. You've got to work on technique. It's about tone production. Lifting up, being straight to the instrument, hands low, working the strokes, okay, which we can talk, it's in my book, it's in Lee Stevens' book, okay, it's in a lot of great books. My book's probably the best, but nevertheless, okay, yeah, that was a joke. All right, but please, you got to work on technique, then you're going to work on your music, okay. Lauren's playing a marimba solo, Jack's playing a bass solo, okay, sorry, Jack, I'm going to keep coming to you. All right, the point is, it doesn't matter, you're going to work on music. It could be music for band. It could be ensemble, percussion ensemble music. It could be drumline music. Doesn't matter. You're going to work on music. Okay? And then at the end or at the beginning, you're going to read for these 5 minutes. Okay? You ready? Cool? Okay? This is how you're going to be successful. Let's take you. What's your name? Philip? So when you practice, Philip, how long is an average practice time?
Around 45 minutes or an hour.
45 minutes to an hour is a really healthy practice time. And you guys are busy. You're in what level of school are you?
Senior.
He's a busy guy. He's got classes. He's got things to take care of. An hour a day is a really healthy devotion. Okay? So, do you play drum set by chance?
A little bit.
Do you have a drum set at home?
Yes.
Okay. Is a drum set part of that hour?
No.
So, drum set would be an additional time playing time?
Yeah.
If you play a drum set, it would be an hour plus something else on drum set.
Every now and then.
Cool. You play drum set more often. But seriously, taking this hour, we would say, okay, 20, we might say 15 minutes for technique, 10 to 15 minutes for technique, okay? 5 to 10 minutes to read something, and then 40 minutes to work on the music, okay? This is a really pretty good mix. Now, it might change for him. I'm not seeing him play. Maybe he needs more time on technique, okay? There was a time in my life when I would spend 2 hours a day on technique because I didn't know any better. I probably wasted a lot, several years behind this instrument trying to figure it out. Okay, but you know, once I figured it out and I got it together, then I could maintain it and I could fit, you know, I didn't have to go through the whole line. Let me give you an example of that. Here's an exercise that I used to do, something like this, right? More like this. So forth, right? Right? You guys know this exercise? Yeah? This will give you strong physical results, no problem. You can learn how to make those motions here. Okay? How many of you guys know a tune that goes like that? Not really. I mean, Yellow After the Rain has a little. Yeah, it goes down the scale. It doesn't go chromatically, right? So, in other words, I woke up one day and went, whoa, time out. I don't know any tunes that go, ba da 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 da, you know. I was like, what am I doing? No. We've got to play something that has a chord progression, right? You guys know what chord progressions are?
Yeah.
Okay, chord progressions are the fundamental progression of Western music, all the way from before Bach's time, all the way through Beethoven and Tchaikovsky and Wagner and Gershwin and Lennon and McCartney, Coltrane, Lady Gaga. Okay, I think she uses chord changes. Yeah, all right, so it's a joke. Okay, the point is that once you start practicing in that fashion, then you're actually using the the basic ideas. And you know what? You like a really cool tune by, what's your favorite band right now, Josh?
Snarky Puppy.
Why, they have some maybe a little more sophisticated chordal progressions, but you could pick one of those chord progressions and play it on the marimba to work your technique. So then you're going to be working your double double verticals. You need to choose a certain progression and take it from there, right? Okay. So what you play is up to you, but how you play it has a really important aspect. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. Do you have any? We're talking a lot. I'm talking a lot. Do you have any questions so far? Okay. All right. So we've got, I know one person that wanted to play for me today, and I can wrap some of these things into his performance as well. Is there anybody besides Eli that wanted to play for me today at this master class? Just Eli? Okay. Eli, are you ready?
Sir.
Section of a piece called Merlin by Andrew Thomas, okay, which is a higher level marimba solo, and he's a graduate student at East Carolina University. Nice shirt.
Appreciate you.
And you're working on your master's there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. And where'd you get your undergrad?
Appalachian State.
Wonderful. Okay.
It's a lot warmer over here, though.
I'm positive didn't expect anybody to read this. Okay, so, but this is a really great point, is that who is going to, when you practice, you don't, in the practice session this morning, Amy and comrades and Nate talked about dividing amount of material that you work on. In this case, it might be just the first line and a half. And in other words, like the concerts tonight, I can play that much tonight. That's how you want to think. Tempo, articulation, phrasing, everything. One line. Do you know this first line by heart?
No.
Oh, not yet. Okay.
Close.
All right, you're close. Now, start the beginning. I'm going to show them what I'm talking about. First off, I've had so many amazing players stand in my office and say, why isn't my sound good? And I'm like, look at your feet. No wonder. There's no way it's possible. Now, with Eli, you've got too much motion in your feet. You're moving, stepping back and forth, and you're twisting yourself. You've got to stay straight and square, and you've got to slide back and forth. We want to move like the music sounds, okay? We want to look like the music is going to sound. And this lifts really soft. And then octaves, octaves, and then comes back. Right? Okay? No steps, but you can shift your weight. Okay? Let's try it. Okay, so you would start further to the right. Okay, that's fine. We'll figure it out. Take a look at your belt buckle. Where's your belt buckle? On the E or the F? The G?
I'm starting at the B natural.
You're starting at the B natural, and then you're shifting. Okay, good. Let's try it. Slide a foot. If you've got to reach a little more, you may have to reach a little bit more. Okay. Also, the instrument doesn't sound very good, does it? Right? What do you think? Does it sound great? No, it doesn't sound. It sounds uneven. It sounds uneven. So you think, well, why is it uneven? Your hands are up. Your hands are high. We talked about it. If your hand is higher than the mallet hit after the stroke, it's going to be more articulate. This is supposed to be hands really low and super soft. He says pianissimo, which you should exaggerate. Okay. So let's try keeping your hands. Okay? Try keeping your hands really low as you while you play this. Nice and easy. Not maybe a little slower too. Yeah. Better. Okay, now I hear him getting to the core of the mallet. Do you hear that? When he gets to the core, it gets to that kind of a crack sound. We want to try to avoid that in this section for certain. Try not to get to that level, okay? Now, it would be better to see if we could play this more inside, but I know you have to do this section to this on the outside. That's cool. Okay, he's got to get this memorized, okay? Because really, the longer you read it, the more difficult it might become to memorize. How much can you play of that line without reading? Let's try it. Certainly one that doesn't get to the core so quick. We've got to look at your bar placement, okay? If you do have to play on the very edge, can the bar stick? Okay, check this out. If I have to play on the edge, check this out. I'm going to measure from the string on the way out. I get this much distance. Now I'm going to measure back in to the bar from the string. You ready to see what I just did? I measured from the string out to the edge of the bar, the very edge, not where it curves, but the very edge. Now I'm going to measure back in. I mean, look where it comes up. It comes up almost to the lot to that post that's holding the resonators. Should be a really good spot. Let's check it out. Okay. Now take that same stick and play on the very edge. Theoretically, it ought to be similar. You hear it? It's close. It's close. But you know what? The sweet spot here is so small. Okay. So you've got to stay right on the edge and almost pretend like you're playing at the keyboard like this matter. Like you're almost kind of like that, okay? You're not really playing it that way, but that's how you're thinking, okay? Because check this out, move in a centimeter. Ooh, big difference, and that's what we're catching. We're getting a lot of that kind of sound, okay? So that's what we're gonna do this time. One more time to run that line, just to show me that line stay really clear and really, just play slow if you want, Eli, it's all good. Hands low, relax. Was the keyboard more even sounding that time?
Yeah,
it was a lot more even sounding.
not overplaying. Now, there was definitely a few notes that kind of ghosted out a little bit, okay? But it was better. We're moving in the right direction. This is how we're going to practice. Take one step at a time. Now, the thing that we're not doing right now is that I'm his recorder. I'm his phone. And I'm saying, Eli, do this, do this, do this, okay? But you don't have me in the practice room, which is probably a good thing for you, I guess, you know? So, but you're going to park that phone here or there, wherever, and you would play that line, then you would watch it and go, no, that's not what I want. I need to do blah, 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 blah. Click it, mark it on the music, do it again, record it, practice it, keep, and don't move on until you go. You guys, are you familiar with Steve Schick? Do you know who he is? Steven Schick is a very famous multi-percussionist, probably one of the most famous multi-percussionists for art music. And he plays these amazing pieces by Brian Ferneyhough and Xenakis and all these and crazy setups where he'll go and play a piece for an hour and a half that deals with two bongos, a woodblock, a frying pan, and a and he memorizes it all. And the New York Times came to him and said, Mr. Schick, how can you memorize a piece that lasts for an hour and a half that's only on these types of instruments? And you know what he said? I never forget his response. He said, well, I learned the first bar. And when I can play everything in the first bar, tempo, articulation, dynamics, everything, then I go to the second bar. Oh, okay. All right. What a genius. I didn't need a Harvard degree to figure that one out. Okay. All right. But you know, this is the same thing I'm suggesting to you, too. Now, some people, Paul Rennick, one of my colleagues at North Texas, he promotes doing the same thing, but starting at the end and moving into a period where you feel more comfortable. That's good, too. Doesn't really matter. As long as you have a system and you have that same kind of approach. Don't play the second bar until you can play the first bar. Okay? And then we move forward. Okay? But pacing is really important. He could practice this piece at a really slow tempo for weeks and be perfect. But when he puts it in tempo, he's back to square one. We've got to be in a pacing. We've got to feel like we're in that style of the music. Okay? You made some progress right there. Okay, first thing is start parking the music over here, get a pencil and a recorder, and it'll take care of itself. There'll be so much that'll happen. And I would suggest changing those things. Okay. Let's hear it for Eli. So Innovative Percussion sent us three sets of mallets to give away. A lot of times when we do these kinds of events, they're raffle, and I don't have any control over who gets what, okay? And I'm gonna give a set of mallets to Alexa after she plays for me, okay? And I might have a set of mallets where did Eli go? Okay, I might have a set of mallets you might consider for your piece. Maybe, maybe not. Try these, Eli. Okay? Let's hear it for Eli. Thank you for playing. Okay, all right. And what piece will you play? It's just Yellow After the Rain. That's not Yellow After the Rain, it's just Yellow.
Oh, it's Yellow After the Rain.
Let's do it. Let's hear it. You know, Mitchell Peters just passed away about 2 months ago. What an amazing colleague and supporter. And while she's setting up, last time I talked to him, I was writing a piece about 5 or 6 years ago. And I was writing a piece called Marimba Heritage, and I was utilizing a couple of his pieces and these quotes. And I sent it to him, and he called me laughing and enjoying it. And he always had a nice talk, but I was so sad to hear that he had passed. Yeah. Okay, so let's do it. We're going to maybe not do the whole thing. We'll just start up. Yeah. Any of you guys ever been sitting in front of a Phillips head screw? You've got to get it out, but you've got a flathead screwdriver, and you're looking at it, you're going, I can do this. Yeah? And it never really works very well, right? You've got to have the right tool for the job. These are concerto mallets designed to kick out in front of an orchestra or concert band, and they've got a lot of high-end kick to them, right? So this really is not going to help you get a lot of good tone. You could practice these on the floor, okay, but right here, maybe not. Okay, let's try these, okay? Now, second thing is, we're gonna talk about lift. Remember what we talked about is that if we keep our hands up and the mallets down, the instrument's gonna be more articulate, right? Okay? Up, 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 okay? You try that open. Think about the mallets almost bouncing off the keyboard. You'll play the right. In terms of a theater, you guys, everybody loves movies, right? Okay, but let's say that we're gonna go to, what's your name? Conley's got, he's got a new movie production company, but he only owns one camera, okay? But he wants all of us to be in the movie, okay? So Conley, am I saying you right? Okay, so Conley says, okay guys, everybody right together, okay? And now you know what? This gentleman right here, he's the lead role, okay? And Lauren is the heroine, okay, right? But everybody's in the shot, and so they're saying their lines, but the audience member doesn't know where to look because they don't know where to pick them out. No. A really good filmographer will go, zoom in, and he'll go, but you weren't there last night. Well, you didn't call me, or whatever, you know, okay. You get the idea, is that the film director directs our attention to where we want to hear, to see the film, right? We gotta do the same thing with the music. We wanna direct the audience attention, and we're gonna do that by making sure that there's no competition with the melody or the moving line, depending on the piece. In this case, it's a melody. Okay, let's try it. Okay, just on right on the melody. Da 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 da. One, two, ready? Eight. Good. Stop. Is it better?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot better. Now we're gonna do it one more time. It's gonna get even stronger. Can we come back? Put your hands up here. You have to be careful not to play on the notes, okay?
Yeah.
Do it and play. I want you to make small motions with your left hand, just easy. Tap them. And notice that the left hand is not in a coma. Excuse me. So it's not. No, it's got motion. Why? Because it's supporting what's happening in the melody. You with me? So there's a shape here too, but it's not as predominant as the other one. Okay? Here we go, let's try it. Two, it's in three, right? And one, ready, in. And you're starting like just like this.
Yeah?
Oops. Okay. Here we go. One, ready, see when you're playing in bad spots. Is it getting better, guys?
Yeah.
Absolutely. sounds more musical, has more sense of phrase. And remember right from the beginning when we started, we were talking about phrases, being able to connect phrases together, okay? And we're gonna do that through dynamic contrast, okay? If we play this note, the melody exactly equal, this is what it sounds like. It sounds really stiff and stale, right? No. The melody has a sense of lift and fall, okay? So we're gonna do that just like the cellist would play it, or just like the singer would do it. We talked about this yesterday in the clinic, okay? Every other instrument in our area in music can connect phrases, can connect notes into phrases by using one primary tool. How does the cello player, the singer, the clarinet player, the trumpet player, how do they connect notes into phrases? With slurs. Can the percussionist slur? No. Okay, now this is a big one, okay? You ready for this one? Okay. Check this out, it means on the trumpet or the cello, you can play that C and I can make that G speak without, for me, it would be like not touching it. They can make the note speak without articulating the note. You with me? Okay, right? Now you know and I know that I'm gonna stand there forever and that G's never gonna speak unless I touch it because we're percussion. Okay, right? So now look, I'm standing here, it's never gonna happen. Bad joke. Sorry, okay. But the idea is that we're gonna pretend that we have that shape. Right? There's a shape. And this left hand is gonna stay out of the way. Okay, let's try it again. Two. Okay, get a good plane spot, nice posture. Open up your stance just a little bit. And one, ready, and. I'm here all day, we got the concert tonight, but I really would like to hear from you. I want to hear what you have to ask me, anything about playing the marimba or anything about North Texas or anything about building a career. I've been fortunate to be a couple of different areas in helping build businesses like Innovative Percussion and Dynasty, as well as an international marimba competition in Poland that I've been involved with. So I have lots of different experiences I'd love to be able to share with you. Just ask me what you want and we can go. Yes.
Which manufacturer do you prefer, Bergeron or Marimba One?
Oh, Bergeron, for certain. This instrument is much more resonant in projection. And I would tell you, what's your name?
Andrew.
Andrew, you need to make your own mind. Look, every instrument is a personal situation, but let me tell you what changed my mind. I was sitting in the back of the hall, and it was at a marimba competition in a beautiful hall, and there was a Malatech, a Marimba One, a Yamaha, the Bergeron, and something else, Adams. You know, instruments on the stage. And you know what? Every instrument could sound pretty good, really. And every instrument could sound like plywood. Okay, and I was like, wow, this is really interesting. So now the Malatech sounds really good, but now the next person comes up with the touch and the mallets, it didn't sound good at all. Okay, but this instrument, when it came on the stage and we started developing it and I was involved in developing this instrument, we started to compare it across the others, and let me tell you, it really projects better, the fundamental is stronger, it's more even, the tuning is better across the board. Okay, I know Marimba One is maybe more popular, but if you put your ears on this, you might change your mind. So I think the most important thing to do is not to assume what is good just because other people use it, but to actually listen and compare. Okay, and if you like the other one, awesome, go for it. You know, that's not a big deal. But if you find yourself like me, you're gonna go, wow, my ears were drawn to this. Stand up behind this instrument and all the sound comes up and it's like, wow. It's different. So that's my answer to that. Okay, every day. Yes?
Do you have any tips for playing with four violins?
have, yeah. Listen, first off, I would tell you that you should, if you're interested in my approach and things that we've talked about today, my book is published by Innovative Percussion. It's called Marimba Technique Through Music. Okay? Why did I write this book? It's because I teach at North Texas. I can't teach everybody at that school. The school is huge. Okay, so I needed to have a text where I knew that if a student A was through the first level barriers, I knew what that student had done, I knew the kinds of skills that were required for that, and so I wrote this book designed for that. And so this, I would tell you to pick up that book. It comes with a DVD. I'm in the process of putting all that stuff online, as video online now as well, but it talks to you about tone production, talks to you about technique, and talks to you about how we do things at North Texas. You know, and so that's, that would be my short answer, considering how much time we have right now. The other tips are to really take time every day to work on technique. Make sure that you have a specific goal on which technique you're working on. Keep a notebook. Today, this week, I'm working on my double vertical and double laterals, and I'm working on these exercises. Don't try to work on 30 exercises. Pick one or two and do them really well, okay? And as you get build confidence and strength and speed and consistency, then you move on. There was a book before there that we don't use anymore. I know it's still being, it's still published. It's the North Texas Mallet Studies.
Right.
Yeah, that Bob Shatroma put together.
Right.
And it's just, these two books do two different things,
okay,
to be honest with you. So yes, it did replace that. But it's, and it's been, that book, my book came out in 05, so it's 12 years ago.
I have a tattered old copy.
Yeah.
I was like, is that still in use, sir?
Not really. No, we haven't used that now in about a dozen years or so. Six mallet technique is not unheard of. I mean, I've had to play, in fact, I have a CD coming out in 10 days where I'm playing six mallets with Keiko Abe on one of the tracks, you know, and you have to do this. You know, am I a six mallet specialist? No, but I know how to do it, okay? Typically with Keiko, when we were playing a piece of Keiko's, is that I would basically hold my Muster Stevens grip, and I could actually put, wait a minute. Could put a Burton grip, I'm sorry, and then put the other mallet right inside that, and she writes in thirds, you know, so it's, once you have that set up, I didn't have to shift it too much, okay, so she would write, and every now and then she would do, you know, put a 6-4 inversion in there, but primarily, but there are other pieces that are much more intensive, and Ludwig Albert plays with 8 mallets, okay, good for him, okay, so, but the reality of the thing is that the four mallet is by far the primary method of playing in terms of multiple mallets. Five mallets, it works awesome with certain pieces, and other pieces it's a bit of a struggle depending on it. And there just hasn't been a lot of pieces. The Yoyama with a saxophone, that's a piece that uses six mallets that is played consistently for decades. So that's been around for a while. There's other pieces. There is a gentleman in Las Vegas whose name is escaping me.
Gronemeyer.
Say it again?
Gronemeyer. Yeah.
He did an amazing article, and he really took this to another level. And my hat's off to him. I was very respectful of his work. I just haven't found it to be as useful in my daily teaching and performance. But I do it from time to time. Sure.
What would you say?
At improv is to study harmony. Study harmony and explore, I'm not a jazzer. I mean, there's lots of different ways that improv. I remember when the first time I had the chance to play with Keiko Abe, I'll tell you a brief story. We were doing a free improvisation. Okay, no basis on harmonic progression at all, just listen to each other and play back and forth what we heard and give it a go. Well, I had been out of town. I picked her up at the airport. I said, let's go get some lunch. We went to get some lunch. She goes, can we stop by the school? We weren't scheduled to rehearse or anything. You know, I knew I had a day to kind of get my hands back in shape because she was going to be there the next day. And she goes, she's looking around the school. And she goes, well, we're here. We should play now. And I was like, oh, okay. You know, so I set her up. I went down to my office. And she goes, give me 20 minutes. And I took my 20 minutes and nothing felt good. You know, I was like, oh my God, Keiko Abe's down the hallway, and I don't feel, this. None of this is gonna be good, you know? And And so I got my stuff, got after 20 minutes, walked down, we beat up the marimbas, you know, and she said, now before we, she has a really soft voice in English, she goes, now before we start, I have to tell you something. I said, well, what's that, Kango? And she goes, I'm very nervous. And I went, me too. And at that point, we were like, okay, whatever, you know, so then we laughed and it was fine. You know, but she loves to do this free improvisation where there's really no fundamental in terms of chord progressions. It's about creating in the moment, like we talked about earlier, where there's no wrong notes. But there's definitely a symmetry between two players that are going to improvise together and how they listen and react to each other. Okay? But for you, I think for anybody, I would tell you to study harmony, study jazz progressions, different types of scales, not just major and minor scales, but making sure you know your modes, making sure you understand how chord symbols are going to work, because that really can set you free with a lot of things. And then learn some tunes, learn some music to apply it to. Yeah. Yes.
What made you decide that you wanted to teach?
I don't know. I think teaching is a part of giving, and I knew it was always part of who I was as a teacher, you know, and there was a time in my life when maybe I could have just focused on playing all the time, but I think I would have been playing a lot of music that I wasn't too crazy about at the time. I was living in Nashville and doing a lot of industrial shows and a lot of jingles and things, and it was kind of cool and kind of fun, but it wasn't a lot of music that I was really driven to, and also I missed the relationship of working with students. And so I don't know, I think this is just something that, I think teachers who are teach love to teach, you know, and I think inside of me, although there's some days when I don't like it so much, okay, I mean, I think that's true of all teachers where we go, wow, what's happening? But I think really when we get down to it, teaching is, for me, is a blessing and it's a gift, and I get back a lot more than I give, I can tell you that. I learn so much from my students and my colleagues. So I think it's a calling, and if you know you have it, then you have to be truthful to yourself. Yeah. Yeah, man.
What was the name of that first piece you played?
It wasn't. It was the Raleigh Snowfall, Rain Snowfall piece. I was just improvising on that one.
Awesome.
Thank you. I was just I like to do that sometimes to open up and just kind of get used to the move my hands a little bit because we've been eating lunch and you know, and we're gonna play some music tonight, so I didn't want to reproduce some pieces that I was gonna do tonight. So really, I start off my practice sessions almost every day with something like that. You know, I'll pick a key, sometimes I'll pick a meter, sometimes I have a feeling, or sometimes I have this, like this this piece that I'm writing for Paul Rennick and I right now. I've yet to play it, I've only heard it on the computer, and we have to do it in like about 10 days. So, you know, I've been starting off just improvising. It kind of starts off with he and I doing this snare drum thing. Boom. And kind of jumps into this kind of figure. You know, and he's got some snare figures going on, then there becomes some dialogue. So I've been kind of improvising with that lately. But normally for me in the daytime, in the morning, especially in the morning, if I have time, I will, you know, just pick a key and say, and just start to mess around with it and see what I can come up with. Sometimes it's cool, sometimes it's not. I have to do the same thing I was suggesting to you. I need to do more study on harmony constantly, always trying to figure it out. Yeah, so. Yes, well, you asked me, what happened to this?
Is there any one piece that really sticks out to you as being a lot of fun as a performer to put on?
All of them. First piece I ever wrote was a piece called Head Talk. And I for me, this was like, this piece was just full of smiles. You cannot play this piece and not smile. I mean, you know, and anybody in here heard this piece before?
That's the one where they're on the floor, right?
Yeah, on the floor with these drum heads and it's a wacky piece, you know. And I was telling people in the composition session, I have these letters from publishers going, we will not publish this piece, no one will ever play this piece. And I was like, really? I mean, it's nothing but smiles, you know? Why can't you play a piece with smiles? And they said the same thing about Stubernick. They said, no one will ever play Stubernick. And I was like, okay, so I just didn't take no for an answer, and I just started to sell the piece out of my house, and eventually we started a publishing company with Innovative, and that's where that went. But, you know, for me, I think probably playing lately for fun is this Stubernick Fantasy, that this concerto that I wrote based on Astastuba and Stubernick. We just recorded it with the North Texas Wind Symphony with Eugene Corporon conducting, Paul Rennick and Sandy Rennick playing with me. And the CD's coming out in 2 weeks, and I'm super excited about that. So maybe that's number one fun right now. Yeah. I don't know, every piece has its own enjoyment. Yeah. Yes?
Do you have like a favorite brand of melons?
I do. I do have a favorite brand of melons. What's your name?
Miles.
Miles, hi Miles.
Hi.
Hey, that's a super cool name, by the way.
Thank you.
Miles, back in, this was in like about 1988, 87 or so, my student Eric Johnson, who was studying with me at Middle Tennessee State University, went to do his master's in North Texas. I was teaching at Middle Tennessee State. And, you know, but before that, I was using old Wirt Firth mallets that had gone out of production. And I couldn't find anything to produce them. And what I was looking for was like a rubber core with a heavier rubber core that would create more fundamental out of the bar. And so I asked Eric, Eric said, I can wrap mallets. So he started wrapping my mallets for me as a student, you know, which he got A's all the time. Okay, so anyway, I finally said, well, Eric, when you get out of school, I said, I have an idea. If you want to start a company, maybe we could do some mallets together. But if it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out, you know. So he went through the master's, was teaching some part-time at colleges, but all of a sudden he found himself calling me and said, I think I really want to do this mallet thing. And by that time I had kind of put some of the raw materials together, and he and I put together the first innovative percussion solo series line. I called Michael Burritt, and he said, yeah, I'm in. So we had Michael Burritt as an artist, and we had our first line of mallets, and now that company is like incredible. I mean, they're really so amazing, so many colors and so many things. So my favorite, Miles is, you know. And of course, these have my name on them, so I've got to use those. So, I really don't use any other brand beside Innovative because I really believe in them. And also, I'm in an awesome position, which I don't know. I mean, it's just incredible that it happened. But if I need a mallet that they don't make, they will make it for me, okay? Which is a blessing, and that's happened a few times when, you know, a certain piece, I got to go between Vibes and Marimba, and I just don't have that mallet that will do. They'll adapt a mallet to help me, you know, and we're dear friends, and it's just an awesome company, and really, I think they make the very best stuff, very best mallets and sticks. So. Okay, anything else? Wow, it's been such a pleasure. Can't wait for the concert tonight and the rest of the clinic. Thank you so much. Thank you, Kuntal, and thank you.